was alive and had been seen by her, they would not believe it. After this, he appeared in another form to two of them as they were walking into the country. This is the word of the God, Lord.
Once and for all time, Jesus entered the most holy place, into the very presence of God. He destroyed the power of death. By his own blood, he restored us. Through one man, sin came into the world. Now one man alone could secure our redemption. Jesus, fully God and fully man. Jesus, our brother. Jesus, our most merciful and faithful high priest, you are the living bread who was broken. You took on our likeness and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. While we were sinners, you died for us, forever tearing down the wall that separates us from the Father and paying the price to purchase back everything we'd lost, our birthright. You ushered in the new covenant and sealed it with your own blood. Our redemption was indeed costly. You are the radiance of God, the exact imprint of his nature. Forever you are exalted, eternal God and Savior. Amen.
Now slide that 3 half-sheet pages worth of sermon notes there in your bulletin and pull that on out. Well, here we are retelling the story of Easter once again. And if you grew up like me, I was a creaster. I only attended church growing up at Christmas time and Easter. A creaster. And so I heard some of the story. I heard that there was a God baby born in a manger in a barn. And then I heard that later on he died and was buried. And then you hunt colored pastel Easter eggs in a cemetery. And something about watch out for the open grave because it's empty and you might fall in. Something about that. That's what I heard growing up. That's what I knew. Some of the story was partially true. And if that's all you heard, you've got some of it as well. But here's the best. This is it. It's the resurrection. This is the best part of the story of Jesus, and I want to tell you why it matters. We read again in Mark 16, verse 1. You can read it out loud with me. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Why did they have to go and buy spices? Well, it's because they didn't have them on hand. Thursday night, when they went to bed, Jesus was still alive. They weren't expecting him to die. And then they heard out that somehow during midnight hours, after they had all gone to bed, that there was a secret council meeting of the Sanhedrin, all the religious leaders, the scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees. They got together, and they determined Jesus had to die. And they wanted to make sure it happened that very next day. So they didn't have spices on hand. Jesus was still alive, according to what they thought, but now he had been arrested. And now he was condemned to die, and he would be crucified. And crucifixion is a painful, agonizing death. The Romans had perfected it. And often a person on a cross can last for days until they finally expire. But Jesus was put on that cross about 9 a.m. Friday morning. And because he had already been beaten to a bloody pulp, had been given 39 lashes, they say 40 will kill a man. He died within 6 hours on the cross. Put on the cross at 9 a.m., died about 3 p.m. And now, though, because the Sabbath was approaching at 6 p.m., the ladies didn't have time to purchase the spices necessary to do any embalming. The first opportunity would have to be Sunday. And then we read what happened then on Sunday morning. They were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll away the stone from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled away. And Luke tells us in his gospel, there are 4 different gospel accounts, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in the Bible, that Luke tells us that those who were there, those women, went inside, found the tomb empty. There was no body there like it should have been. And yet these women did not assume a miracle. They assumed that there would be a body present in that tomb. And since it wasn't, now they thought it must have been stolen. So they run back to the city, they find the disciples, and they let them know. And these brave disciples are all hiding. They're hiding out in an upper room somewhere. They're fearful because Pilate had given the religious leaders permission to have Jesus crucified at the hands of the Romans. And so they were expecting that it must now be open season on anybody affiliated with Jesus. They're hiding. That's how brave they were. But Mary bursts into the room, and according to John's gospel in John 20, she said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb. And we don't know where they have put him." Not only is the body missing, but more disturbingly, they took him, and we don't know who they are. We continue to read on about the disciples' response, though, in, again, Luke's gospel. They did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. So let's hit the pause button on this narrative for a moment and think about this. It could be that, like so many people have respect for Jesus. And they know that he was an historical figure, and that's not disputed at all. Jesus was, in fact, a real person. He was here. He lived some 2,000 years ago, and he did die on a Roman cross. But maybe this whole resurrection thing seems like nonsense to you. How can that possibly be? Well, let me tell you, if that's how you're thinking, good news, you are in good company. Even Jesus' best friends, those first century disciples, they felt exactly the same way. The body of their friend had been stolen, and now they needed to find it. We read on now in Luke's gospel. Read it with me. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. How fascinating I find it that the writers of the gospel didn't hide anything here. They penned their disbelief and skepticism, the very ones who would later on become the spokespersons for this new movement. They documented, fill in your blanks, they documented their own disbelief. That's amazing, isn't it? Why would you do that? Why would you tell on yourself that way? They were willing to say, though, we didn't get it. We wish we could write about our great faith and how we stood up for Jesus and how we anticipated his resurrection, and we never gave up hope. It would make them look a lot better, but that's not the story. And they were willing to be factual about it. The story was in John 20:19, on the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, again they were gathered in hiding. They did not assume a resurrection. That was the farthest thing from their minds. They assumed the body was stolen. Now let's read on. Mark 16:14. Later, he appeared to the 11 as they were sitting at the table. That is, Jesus came and paid those disciples a visit. They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. But he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why are there doubts in your mind?" Again, Luke doesn't paint a pretty picture of the disciples. They lost hope. They lost faith. They didn't think there was a resurrection. Even though Jesus told them time after time again this would be happening, they thought, no way. They was expecting a body, a dead body. And yet here he is in front of them. And he said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms." Now the law of Moses, the prophets and the Psalms, that was the Old Testament. That's what they had. They were scrolls that they had. And so that was all that they knew of God's word. The entire Jewish scriptures, Jesus says, though, they talk about me. They also mention that the Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And then Jesus says something that will change their lives, as if the resurrection and his appearance right in front of them didn't do it yet. He said to those who followed him, who abandoned him and now were following and ready to believe again, he said, "You are witnesses of these things." They were the eyewitnesses of all these events that then triggered a movement that would change the world. And it so changed the world that here we are today talking about it 2,000 years later, still celebrating Jesus risen from the grave. It's so important to know then that if you've given up on Christianity, or maybe you've rejected faith, maybe you're questioning this Christian thing, maybe you're a weak Christian. Here it is. The resurrection of Jesus created Christianity. The resurrection of Jesus launched the church. Fill in those blanks. That's important. It was not just the teachings of Jesus that launched it. It wasn't just the morality of Jesus or the fact that he brought new life and standards to human life, that men and women are the same, that there is no difference between Jew and a foreigner, or all those things that he talked about, Greek or any of those. He says we're all one. It wasn't all of that teaching that changed the world either. It was this event, the resurrection, Jesus coming back to life after being dead 3 days. Because get this, when Jesus was dead and buried, just sitting in the grave there, Friday, Saturday, and early part of Sunday, there were no Christians then. There were no one because nobody believed. Everybody had given up on Jesus. They'd given up even on what they had done the last 3 years of his ministry. They were not expecting a resurrection. Sure, Jesus could raise Jairus' daughter from the dead, and he could even raise Lazarus from the dead, because Jesus had that power while he was alive. So if he's dead, then there must be no more power. They weren't assuming a resurrection at all. There was no one to bring Jesus back from death. But here we know. Now we know it. Jesus is able to do what he said he would do. And we don't believe Jesus rose from the dead just because the Bible says so. We believe it because of the eyewitnesses. The eyewitnesses saw Jesus resurrected again. They spent some 40 days with him, and at times even appeared to a crowd of over 500. They saw him, they touched him, they felt him, they heard him. They even had a meal with him, many did. In fact, Matthew and John, those early disciples, they verified Jesus was alive again. They saw him, they touched him, they ate with him. Mark, when you read Mark's gospel, Mark wasn't there. So why did Mark write it down? Because Peter told him the story. Peter told him, this is how it happened. This is the events of Jesus' life. And then Luke, who wasn't there either. Luke didn't come along for a couple years yet. Yet he did some investigation on his own. He thoroughly investigated the eyewitness's account. You read about that in the book of Acts. He says, I did some research. I dotted my I's and crossed my T's and all those things. He says, I talked to people who saw. I spoke with persons who witnessed it all. That's why we believe. And then Peter himself, who wrote an epistle, we're going to be looking at some of those verses. He said, I beheld my resurrected friend. We have the account of James. James was the half-brother of Jesus, a lot younger than Jesus, but he grew up in the same household with Mary and Joseph until Joseph leaves the picture. We're not sure why. Probably died an early death as a young adult. But James came to believe. That's amazing. Anybody here in the room have a brother? Anybody in the room have a brother? What would it take for your brother to convince you that he was God? And yet somehow Jesus convinced James that he was God. James, how did you come to believe? Well, because I was there the day he died, and I later saw him alive. The only conclusion that I can reach is that Jesus is Lord. Jesus is who he claimed to be. And then we can read about Paul in the New Testament as well. A Paul who would say he was the last and the least. He encountered the living Jesus a couple of years after. Jesus showed up and appeared to him, and he believed. And then Paul went and did ministry in the Mediterranean area and also Asia Minor, and he wrote a third of our New Testament. We believe because of their testimonies. And yes, they later wrote those things down, and yes, they were compiled together. These writings were copied. They were distributed all over the area from Jerusalem on out through Europe and even through Asia Minor. And in fact, there are some 10,000 separate, distinct manuscripts or copies that have been found in different parts of the world, attesting to the resurrection of Jesus. They were later bound together in what we know as the New Testament and what we have now as the Bible. And here's the Easter story. Here's why Easter matters. The foundation of the Christian faith is not faith. The foundation of the Christian faith is not a book. The foundation of the Christian faith is this event, the resurrection of Jesus. Let's read some from what Peter said in his epistle. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope. Peter gets it now. This has been years later now, probably some 20, 30 years after his actual experience with Jesus. And he's writing these things down. I recognize now that in his great mercy, he has given us new birth, a living hope. This is what Jesus meant when he said, you must be born again. If you believe that Jesus has resurrected from the dead, if you believe that what he did on the cross is a payment in full for sin, that he took upon God, he took upon himself God's wrath towards sin, and that was wreaked out on the cross. It was agonized out on the cross in his death. Then you have this new birth and a living hope. He says, I see it now. I see it now because of Jesus. We have a different kind of new life and hope. And hope here is not a verb. So often we'll often say, well, I hope to make $1 million someday, or I hope to marry a pretty girl, or whatever that is. No, that's a verb. This is a noun, hope. We have a hope. And so let's ask Peter, what is the basis of this hope? Is it healings, Peter? Do you believe and have hope because of the healings that Jesus did? After all, you saw him raise people from the dead. You saw him give sight back to the blind. You saw him give legs back to those who couldn't walk. What was it? The parables, Peter. Maybe it was the parables. That's why you believe, right? Because of those great stories and how Jesus weaved life and theology together. No, it wasn't that. How about the truths that Jesus brought out, such as in the Sermon on the Mount? No, it wasn't that. How about the miracles? After all, you even got to walk on water with Jesus. Peter, is that why you believe? And he says, no. Well, then what gives you confidence and hope? Peter finishes the sentence there in verse 3. Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. That's why I believe. Jesus not only died, but he came back to life. That's why I believe. And he says we are given then an inheritance. This hope is like an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. So who gets an inheritance? One day your kids do, right? Children do. And so they are the heirs. And so you and I are the heirs, daughters and sons of God, who get this incredible hope, this presence of Jesus through what he has done, through his resurrection. Peter just isn't talking about historical events or even facts. He's speaking relationally here, that the resurrection of Jesus allowed for something special to happen, that you and I can have a special personal relationship with our Heavenly Father. That is now available through what Jesus has done. It wasn't possible before. And Jesus even stated that when he had communion, in that communion sacrament, when he said, I am presenting to you a new covenant, a new relationship, a new agreement, a way for you to relate to God through my blood, through my body, given for you. This is now a new relationship that is established between God our Father and his children, allowing us to call God Heavenly Father. And then what comes next, I think, is most extraordinary. He says, this inheritance is kept for you in heaven. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. Peter believed in heaven. And that's interesting because at that time, many Jews didn't know if there was a heaven or not. Even the Sadducees and the Pharisees argued over that for hundreds of years. The Pharisees thinking, yes, there's an afterlife experience after death. And the Sadducees thought, no, once you die, you're dead, and that's it. That's the end. But Peter believed in heaven, not because he grew up being taught it, or not because it was something that he learned in Sunday school, or probably Sabbath school, I guess they would have had then. But he experienced it in Jesus. After all, Jesus said, I am here to proclaim the kingdom of God, which is at hand. It begins now. The kingdom of heaven is here now. And we'll experience it in our lifetime here, but the best is yet to come. It's a now and it's a then. And it's an eternal thing, this kingdom of heaven, this new relationship with our Father. Jesus talked about it over and over again. And Peter shared then, connecting the dots with those who may have given up on their faith, those who have doubts, or those who've never believed. He said in verse 6, read it with me, in all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. We can rejoice now, even if we've had to suffer. You see, Peter did not doubt God or God's love based on suffering. A lot of people think that. Well, if I'm suffering, then there must be no God. Peter at first hand witnessed and experienced great unimaginable suffering. He saw that in Jesus. Jesus suffered unimaginably. And yet this did not undermine Peter's faith. Peter did not tether his faith to just a fairy tale God. You know, that fairy tale God who never lets bad things happen to good people. Peter saw the worst thing imaginable. Write that down. Peter saw the worst thing imaginable happen to the best person he'd ever known. And yet Jesus came back from the dead. He came back to life. And Peter's entire life was reframed because of the resurrection. And so now, then, in the next few verses, Peter draws back from a time when Jesus first stepped onto the scene in ministry, back on the banks of the Jordan River, when Jesus was baptized by John the Baptizer, who proclaimed, this, behold, is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. No one knew what John was talking about then. That didn't make sense. But now it does. It meant something probably at the communion service when Jesus said, we have a Passover, and the Passover is lamb's blood, but now it's my blood that's going to be shed and will cover sins. Read this with me, verses 18 and 19. For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed. Stop there a moment. So what redeemed you? What bought you back? What brought you back from death to life? What brought you back from the realm of sin now to righteousness? What redeemed you? Let's read on. It was the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. So here's the point. Through the resurrection, we know that God is for us. Through the resurrection, we know that Jesus died for us. And not because things always work out for us. Despite that, God did all of this. So why does Easter matter? What is the foundation of our faith? It's not faith itself. It's not a book. It is the event of the resurrection. And because of the resurrection, we know with certainty that God is. God is. And we know with certainty that God is personal. Through the resurrection, we know with certainty that suffering is not the evidence of God's absence. We can know with certainty because of the resurrection that heaven is real. We know with certainty because of the resurrection that forgiveness is available. When Jesus came back to life, the resurrection punctuated his authority and his power to forgive sins. Because when he died, nobody knew. When he just died and they thought that was it. So did Jesus really mean what he said all those times when he said, your sin is forgiven? We don't know because he's dead. It kind of goes back to something that Jesus did in a miracle. There was a paraplegic and his friends brought him before Jesus, and yet they couldn't get to him because of all the crowds that were there. Jesus was actually teaching from a house, somehow able to project outside to all the crowds around him. And so those friends took their paralegic friend up on the roof, and they dug a hole through the thatched roof, and they let down him on cords in the presence of Jesus. And what did Jesus first say to him? Hi, buddy, how you doing? He didn't say that at all, did he? Or he didn't say, be healed. He didn't say that at first, did he? But he said this, son, your sins are forgiven. And that caught the ear of those religious Pharisees and Sadducees who were questioning Jesus' authority. How dare he say he can forgive sins? Because the scripture tells us that only God can forgive sins. This Jesus, he's just a man in human flesh. We see him right there. There's nothing godly about him. How can he say your sins are forgiven? And do you know what Jesus did? He said, to prove that I can forgive sins, I'll do something else. I'll do something that you can see. Because you can just say the words you're forgiven, but you don't know. You can't see it. So Jesus said, I'll give you something that you can see. I will tell this man to get up and take up your cot and walk. That is, I'll heal him to prove that I've forgiven his sins. And that's exactly what Jesus did. But now with his resurrection, Jesus punctuates for all to us that yes, he has the power to forgive sins. That's a great thing. That's the certainty we have in the resurrection. And that's the last one. Because of the resurrection, we know with certainty that we are loved. You are loved by God. With certainty, you can know that. You are loved by God. Your Heavenly Father wants to have a relationship with you. Your Heavenly Father wants to become a personal friend in God to you. That's the importance of the resurrection. That's why it matters. Let me pray for us. Lord Jesus, we are grateful for this day to celebrate the greatest event in all history, that you rose from the dead. You proclaimed it that it would happen, and then it did. You did exactly what you said. Nobody else has ever done that. Buddha has not done that. Confucius has not done that. Muhammad has not done that. Only you have done that. You are the Lord. You are the Son of God. And you are God in the flesh. Lord, I pray this day that we would honor you. And maybe there's somebody in this room that doesn't have a clue. Maybe there's somebody in this room that doesn't understand it yet. But maybe this is the day when they say, Jesus, I want to have a relationship with you. I want to believe and I want to have faith and I want to be a different person. And yes, I confess that I've been sinful. I confess that I've rebelled against you. I have not lived life your way. So I'm confessing that now and I'm asking you to forgive me. And then I'm claiming that what you did on the cross pays for my sinfulness. What you did on the cross, you took my sin there and it was dealt with on the cross. You took all the wrath of God that should be on me. But you took it. And so I'm believing in faith, and I want to be your follower, Lord. Be the Lord of my life. Come into my life. Make me a new person. Help me to be the person you want me to be. And so, Lord, I pray for anybody who's prayed like that this morning, that today this would be the day when they say yes to you, and that, Holy Spirit, you would come upon them and let them know that now, right now, they are a son or a daughter in Christ. Right now, you claim them. They are yours. You have bought them with a price, the price of the precious blood of Jesus, and they belong to you. Let them know that now, Lord, that you claim them, that you love them, that you're going to pursue them in a relationship. Lord, I pray also that they would get into your word to find out more about you, to develop this relationship with you, to get into a great Bible preaching church. It could be this one, it could be another. And I pray, Lord, that you would continue to work in them. Tomorrow they'll be tempted to go back to being the same old person they were. But remind them, no, you are different now. Jesus claims you, and you belong to him. Lord, remind us all of that, even as believers, Lord. Sometimes we forget that, and we go back into our work week just like we were before. No, you have bought us with a price. Give us the courage then, Lord, to live for you. Give us the courage to be the hands and feet of Jesus for somebody else who might need to see that. We pray all these things in your name and bring you honor and glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, let's sing another great song as we conclude today. And we're going to sing Up From the Grave He Arose. Let's stand together.